World's most beautiful. Congratulations. Are you excited?
I am. I'm very flattered.
So you still get excited when people call you beautiful. It has happened for a long time. This is your fifth time on the cover of World's Most Beautiful.
Really?
Yes. You're number five.
Wow.
George Clooney, 2 times. Sexiest Man Alive, Julia Roberts, 5.
5 times.
Yeah.
I'm going to mention that in my Christmas card to the Clooneys this year. Wow, 5 times. Well, it is flattering. Yes.
Flattering versus embarrassing.
It will become embarrassing. Right now, let's just keep it with flattering.
When you look at yourself on the cover of World's Most Beautiful or in a Lancome ad, when you see yourself professionally done,
yes,
and you're at your very, very best, looks-wise, do you think, oh, I look good? Or do you still feel like all of us and you're the awkward teenager and you just can't stand to look at photos of yourself?
Well, it's kind of both. I mean, certainly there are times when I come home from work and when I'm washing all of Genevieve's hard work and you just see it swirling down the drain.
Genevieve.
Back. Or can you wrap yourself in toilet paper for the night or something just to preserve it a little bit longer? But yeah, I mean, what a great bonus of my job to have really talented people know how to spruce it all up.
The first time you were on World's Most Beautiful, it was 1991.
Okay, let's think back.
Right.
Let's get in our time machine.
Get in a time machine, 23 years old.
Wow.
And it was on the heels of...
Was I old enough to be voted into this
level of I'm not sure it was legal what we did, but you were the world's most beautiful. And it was during that time of your life, right after it was Steel Magnolias, and then Oscar nominations and Pretty Woman. It was a very heady time in your life. When you look back at yourself at 23, what would you say you were like?
Just very... adorable and naive and so happy to be invited to the party. You know, I mean, I was also working a lot, kind of
right,
in the crazy, crazy excitement time. Like when people say, oh, you know, when Pretty Woman came out, it must have really changed your life. And it's kind of become this joke, but the truth is, and I say, well, I was out of town when Pretty Woman came out.
Right.
And I was, because I was on another movie in this tiny little town that was showing Star Wars in its first run. And I mean, I remember reading something about it in USA Today that said, you know, Pretty Woman came out this weekend and made this much money. And I thought, is that a lot of money? Is that good? Is that great? I didn't really know.
Because you were just working and you were in your own little universe, you were sort of shielded from the fact that at that moment, everyone in the world suddenly knew who you were.
Yes.
That's probably good.
It has worked out for me, I think. Yeah, I really do think it was wildly to my advantage that I wasn't there to get caught up in that excitement.
Was it difficult when you got out of that bubble and realized that the entire world knew who you were and cared about every single thing about you?
There was a moment in time when that was a bigger challenge to me. But it was also the time when paparazzi were more hiding in bushes,
mm-hmm,
and would sort of jump out. And so I didn't like any of that. Call me crazy. I didn't like men jumping out in the dark and taking my picture. So I did get a little thrown off balance for a period of time from all that.
Is there anything that you know now about life, about people, that you wish you had known then?
I wish I had known that I could say no to the media in a way that didn't seem bad-mannered. I wish I had kept more for myself and to myself. But I was just so under the impression that I had to be nice, I had to answer all the questions, and I wish I had realized that I didn't have to do that, and I could still be nice and present myself with kindness and not answer all the questions.
You and I met in 2001, 16 years ago. The following year, you would marry Danny and then eventually start a family, mm-hmm. and your life would change a lot. And I realized at that time, in 2001, that was probably, when I met you, a real turning point in your life, when you were starting to figure out not necessarily what you wanted in life, because you probably knew that for a long time, but you were figuring out how to do it, mm-hmm. how to have a private life.
Well, how to be in absolute control of certain aspects of life and those choices, because there's some things that just aren't ever going to be in my control, and also to find the peace with that, as opposed to screaming into the wind of why can this happen and that happen and it doesn't, you know, I'm not part of it. And just to become far less concerned with outside influences and go more inside and make that the real depth of life.
Does it take a lot of work to keep the outside influences? Because you can't go to the grocery store without reading about yourself or you're looking on the internet. I mean, you're Julia Roberts. How do you escape that?
Well, it's practice, you know, but I do believe that I don't need to know every weird, mean, untrue, odd, you know, I only eat popcorn, or, you know, my husband doesn't love me unless I wear blue, you know. I don't need to know all these
things. You mean those two things are not true?
Those two things.
Good. Finally figured that out.
But it does take a little bit of practice. But you'd be surprised. I go to the grocery on a regular basis, and it's usually an uneventful experience. There are the odd occasions where, you know, I'm waiting and I'm looking around. I'm like, what? What? Turn to the man behind me and go, not true, sir.
What do you do to de-stress? You've done yoga. Is there meditation? What's the thing every day that you do to sort of stay centered or to just relax?
Well, I think it's a lot of things you have to do. If it was one thing, I'd have a lot more time to play Mahjong. Just one thing to do. Oh, there I am, centered, good to go for the rest of the day, like filling up your car with gas. But I think so much of it just has to do with knowing your intention of every day. I mean, I do wake up every day with an intention and a purpose and a focus, and it's only when I get away from that that things can go off the rails.
What's a perfect day?
I can't tell you on camera, Jess. Making my cheeks turn pink. I just, you know, to be with
Is it even legal?
It is. Well, maybe not in the southern states. No, it's just to be with my family and everybody feeling happy, and, you know, we run around and to play and just share time together.
You do a lot of charity work. Some of it you do very under the radar, and some of it you do publicly. But it is a thing that keeps you a lot busier, I know, than a lot of people realize. And I wanted to ask, when you had fame so early, and there must have been a moment in time when you realized, I have this, and in many ways it's great, and in many ways it's terrible, but it is necessary to use that for good in some way outside of myself. Was there a moment, or did you always just sort of know that?
Well, I think I was raised with the idea of, you know, being helpful and being part of a community and being part of something bigger than yourself, and raised with the idea that the quickest way to minimize your own problems is to really examine the bigger problems of the world and to find your own gratitude in that. So I think it is something that my parents instilled in me, and My husband certainly does. And at this point, as a parent, I feel it's an obligation to lead by example of openness and extending yourself towards others in whatever way you can. Sometimes it's in a big way and sometimes it's in a small way.
Richard Curtis, who wrote maybe my favorite Julia Roberts movie, Notting Hill, has founded and very involved in Red Nose Day.
Yeah.
And you have been very involved in Red Nose Day, which is a huge initiative to fight childhood poverty. Mm-hmm. And you just got back from Africa. What was that trip?
Well, first of all, I have to say Richard Curtis and Emma Freud, two of my favorite people in the world and two of the most incredibly hardworking, generous. They are so devoted to the cause of others and helping others, poverty, prevented childhood diseases. I mean, I can't even believe what they do 365 days of the year. And it does kind of all come to this pinnacle on Red Nose Day, which is exciting. And what they do all year long is astounding and exhausting. I can't even talk to them without getting tired, just them telling me all the great things they've been doing. So when Richard and I went to Kenya a couple of weeks ago, and it was just one of these things. It was so illuminating because we live in such a global society now that you really do have a way to see other parts of the world that you just couldn't before. So you really can see how people are living and what they're living with and what they're living without. So you have an idea, and I didn't realize to be there and stand in some of these places and talk to some of these people, it really is striking that we really don't know. We don't know how hot it is. We don't know what it really feels like to stand in these tiny little alleyways with houses here and houses there, and what these people are living through and finding all the best elements to life and just bringing that to the surface on a daily basis. It is just amazing. And the clinics that we went to and these children, it's hot and they're sleeping, and the doctor who was so kind and taking us around and talking to us, you could see as soon as the children would hear his voice, they kind of just look happier, you know, and you think, this is an amazing doctor. With beds in the hallways, kids everywhere, and he's just making the best with what he has. And it's so incredible and it's so encouraging. And I think I came home feeling not in this down way that I kind of imagined, but I was so excited and encouraged by all the spirit that I saw and all the help that I realized could be done. I mean, I really came home feeling so incredible.
Your twins are going to be teenagers soon, this year.
Mm-hmm. Yes, is true.
Did you not know that?
You say it like that.
I'm sorry to spring that on you.
I should be doing something about that.
How are your kids, and you have three, how are your kids different from you and how are they like you?
Well, I think they all have a very keen sense of humor. It's different. They each sort of have a different style of humor. But I do think they're all pretty darn funny. And I really hope that they get that from me because that's what I tell everybody. Very funny. I mean, last night we were playing a game, all of us, my whole family, my sister and my brother-in-law, in stitches, just tears streaming down our faces, having the best time. So I really enjoy that.
What game do you play on family game night?
Well, we were playing some Mahjong, but then we were playing this game.
Do you make them play Mahjong?
They do play Mahjong.
Do they?
Yes. They were playing Mahjong with my sister when I left to come to work today. And Finn moshed. He sent me a picture.
I was once with you and George Clooney, and he is traumatized by the amount of Mahjong. Apparently, you've made him play.
Okay.
And he would no doubt call child services right now.
He has a beautiful Mahjong set that I gave him. And one day, he will find a deep place of appreciation for what an incredible game it is. I don't think anytime soon, but one day.
What do you tell your daughter and your sons about beauty and appearance, pressure to dress a certain way, being individuals in the way they look? Do you encourage them in that way?
Well, it's an interesting navigation because you don't want to mess them up. You know, you don't want to make them aware of something that it was better if they weren't aware of it. I don't know. I think as long as everybody smells good and has a smile on their face, and that's a beauty regime.
When you were a kid, would you say you were a happy kid? How would you describe yourself as a kid?
How old is a kid?
9.
Not happy.
13. Just, we're going to go through each year.
Keep going. 24. Better. No, I was awkward and, you know, like everybody. I mean, there's really only 4 people who were fabulous. And unfortunately, I went to high school with all 4 of them.
Where are they now?
Do you want to know something?
Yes.
Yesterday, we had a Skype call to a boy that I went to school with who was smart and a football player and handsome and dated the prettiest girl, not as pretty as his wife, but back then was the prettiest girl. And he went on to become an astronaut, and he is in space. And we Skyped with him yesterday, and he like floated, and he just told us all about this space mission that he's on. And I told him, you are officially the coolest guy I went to high school with.
Okay, but people who have their glory days in high school are not allowed to become astronauts.
But you know what?
Is there a justice warehouse?
He goes against all the rules, and there have been plenty of movies made about these rules. You peak too early, it's all downhill. But I think he just went to school and studied, and he was in the military and then went on to become an astronaut.
Do you look back and think, I peaked at X, or do you think you peak now?
I think I'm currently peaking.
Do you? You don't think the peak is yet to come?
That was such a question mark, do you? It's funny because that is not how I feel.
Because no one else feels that way.
I think I'm a slow rise. I think it's all, you know, I'm like a Thanksgiving dinner roll.
What were you confident about when you were young, and what were you insecure about, again, as a teenager?
I think I was confident that it would all be okay, always. I think I always knew that there was something optimistic in me, always.
Insecurities?
Everything else.
Really?
Yeah.
Where did the confidence that everything was going to be okay come from?
Just my way through it, and then just one day it stuck.
What did you get from your mother during those years?
My way through it.
She encouraged that.
Oh, she absolutely, leading by example. And also I think she really taught me a love of the details of the things one could accomplish in their own home. You know, she was a great cook and really took pride in our home.
When you lost your mother a couple of years ago, mm-hmm. did the things that you remember from her, the things that she taught you, did those crystallize for you when she was gone?
You know, I think it's in a state of flow where things will come to me, or just my gratitude of something is sharper. I think I'm very fortunate that, I mean, my mom worked a full-time job and, you know, raised 3 girls pretty much on her own. And as my brother's older, so he was gone and out of the house. And I think that, you know, she never showed the strain of it. I think it's incredible. And I remember saying to her one time, I think I might have had 3 children under 3 years old. And I was like, Mom, how did you do this? And instead of, you know, saying, well, you just have to apply yourself. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it takes effort. She goes, it's called daycare, honey. I took you guys to daycare 7 o'clock in the morning and I picked you up at 5. I was at work all day. And I was so appreciative, so grateful that she didn't tell me some sage story about what it's like to be a great mother.
It's been 26 years since you first appeared as World's Most Beautiful. Where do you see yourself 26 years from now?
75 years old. Where do you see yourself?
Well, I hope I'm alive. I mean, I literally can't get any further than that.
Yeah, let's just be alive.
Yeah.
Let's just not,
so, you know
not
what?
Be...
Solvent. I'd like to be alive and solvent.
I think, you know, if I can just grow, you know, gracefully-ish old and, you know, watch my kids grow up and realize their dreams and find their person in life and you know, hopefully have a family and little creatures for Danny and I to spoil. That's, you know, that's what the winter of life is supposed to be about.
You look forward to being a grandmother.
I guess. I mean, God, that sounds really premature right now. You had me all scared about teenagers, and now, like, I'm a grandmother. I'm still in my 40s.
All right. This is a list of firsts and lasts.
Okay.
You ready? Uh-huh. I know you like these fast things.
I do like fast things.
All right. First person who ever called you beautiful.
Oh, probably my dad.
First big thing you bought for yourself.
A car.
First time you wore makeup.
Oh, I was dreadful. My mom always did this like fabulous eyeliner thing. She had a liquid eyeliner, and I took her liquid eyeliner and tried to put it on the the inside of my eyelids, and then I closed my eyes. That's black eyeballs. I was like, I'm blind. It was horrible. I stick with the professionals is
right.
What I say.
First thing you do when you get home?
Kiss my family.
First movie you ever saw?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. I'm thinking somewhere between Benji and Macon County Line. Very different films.
Very different films. First time you ever stood up for yourself?
Yeah. I did a good job, let's just put it that way.
First date.
My first, like, real date, like, getting in somebody's car, I don't think I should say. What if he hasn't told anybody?
Something tells me that he has told everybody.
You never
that
know.
He knows.
You never know.
First job.
My first job was at Showbiz Pizza across from Cumberland Mall, and I worked at the cashier, and then on the weekends when we had birthday parties, I wore the bear suit and brought out the birthday cake.
How was that bear suit?
Well, there was an internal fan.
Oh, I was going to, the heat was going to be my next question.
Yeah.
But it had a fan inside the bear suit.
In the head, you could press a button on the top. It helped, but it was no salve for how many people had worn it before me.
No. And these are a series of lasts.
Okay.
The last time.
Are these going to get sad?
No.
Okay.
No. They're even better.
Okay.
And more entertaining.
Okay.
And insouciant than the previous. The last time you danced?
Oh, Well, Dance Like Danced My Ass Off was my birthday. Yeah.
The last time you laughed really, really hard.
Last night.
Playing games.
Yes.
The last time you were moved to tears.
Seeing Dear Evan Hansen a few days ago.
The last time you were starstruck.
Well, I'm remembering the time I was probably the most starstruck. So can we go from last to most
sure.
for a moment? I'd been very ill, so I was particularly in a vulnerable constitution and had to do a press junket for something. This was a very long time ago. And at the hotel, there was another press junket going on at the same time. And the other press junket was for a movie starring Gene Hackman. And he was coming out of the elevator as I was going into the elevator. And it was one of these moments where I saw him and I went, oh my God. I start sobbing.
What did he do? Security.
He was very nice about it, but I could not stop crying.
I wonder why you cried.
I think I was
That's an odd reaction, sort of.
I don't know, I got lightheaded and I was so startled, and there he was, and he's so tall and handsome, and he's Gene Hackman, and I just was overcome. Couldn't stop crying, and he could not have been sweeter about it. And then later in the day, we sort of passed each other in the lobby. I was like,
the last time you had a sleepless night.
It was probably in Africa. Baboons. I was a little, when I got out of my tent to go to the bathroom in the night, and I was like, God, I thought I was going to be dragged off into the forest.
The last recurring dream that you dreamed.
I'm not good at remembering my dreams.
Do you ever have recurring dreams?
I don't think I do.
Anything?
I mean, I think every day my husband walks in the door, it's like a recurring dream. I'm like, oh, he's back. It's true.
That's so sweet.
That's true.
Who wouldn't want their wife to say that about them?
That's true.
The last wardrobe malfunction.
That is a good question. Well, there's some openings in this blouse that were unexpected when I first put it on. Thus, my fetching blazer.
Is that right? I was going to say that this looks very prudent, this blouse. You look...
Not from the back.
Very nice.
Thank you.
The last time you kept something from the set.
I think I might have kept a couple of trinkets from my bedroom in August, Osage County, like in Merrill's house, where our little girlhood bedrooms were. I think I kept a couple of little trinkets from the bookshelf.
The last time that you were reminded of your mom.
It's funny because her name was Betty, and I feel like lately all I have to do is just, she crosses my mind and I'll turn and I'll see something that says Betty, just unexpectedly. Even in Africa, I saw the name twice on signs when I was thinking about her. Betty in Africa? And the kids talk about her a lot. Mm-hmm. I know for certain that the things that I would think, oh, mom, that now when my kids talk about those very things, I would think, mom, you can't talk like that in front of the kids. They talk about it like she was the coolest grandma. Oh, remember when grandma, you know, dropped the oranges walking in the house and she said, oh crap, remember that? And they talk about it like it just made her the coolest grandma, or that she drove a car without a roof. That's what
without a roof.
That's what Henry used to call it instead of a convertible, a word he didn't know as a 5-year-old. He'd say, my grandma drives a car without a roof. That's so sweet.
Because you are the world's most beautiful woman.
I like the way that you really just, there's somehow you put so much weight into the word.
It's a weighty world.
I just like world. I like that when you say it like that.
And because everybody wants to know.
Like, it's not just this borough.
No,
it is the world.
I'm going to bring in one of the smartest beauty editors in all of New York to ask the world's most beautiful woman about beauty.
I would prefer if she were to tell me all the tricks of the trade she's learned.
And it's Andrea Labenthal. Yeah, just come around here, Andrea.
So you're our world's most beautiful woman. I don't know if Jess mentioned that to you a few times.
It rings a distant bell.
Who or what do you find beautiful?
Well, I believe all the corny answers are true, that just people to me that seem truly happy, you know, that's the thing that attracts us to one another is, you know, that joy and how we wear it on our face, and that brings a comfort. I mean, you know, I have called her out before, so I'll do it again, but my neighbor, Mrs. Schreiber, who just turned 92 years old a couple of weeks ago, she's stunning. Now swimming in the ocean and driving her car and taking her walks, and you know, she just radiates. And I think it's just because she's happy in her life. That's what makes everybody the most gorgeous.
And you probably hook her up with some Lancome, some good cream.
I would. If she asked for it, I'd give her anything.
So if you could give any style or beauty advice to your 15-year-old self, what would it be?
Oh my God. Stay home. That might be it. I grew up, the critical teenage years were the 80s, mm-hmm. when it was all about Calvin Klein and Gloria Vanderbilt and all these really expensive brands. And I was so desperate. I just thought that was going to be the answer to all of my problems, if I could just get a pair of Gloria Vanderbilt jeans, and which was out of my reach. So I think just to say, like, that swan stitched on the back pocket isn't going to make your life any better.
You once said that you're confident when you're comfortable. So I was wondering, are you ever comfortable on a red carpet? Like, is it physically possible to be comfortable?
That is a good question. It's not, because it's not natural to be walking down a centerway with people screaming on both sides of you. So you shouldn't be comfortable. But that's not to say that it can't be thrilling and exciting as well as terrifying.
And then there's the shoes, obviously.
Yes.
Wearing heels for that long. Speaking of the red carpet, what's your favorite look you've ever worn?
Oh my goodness. Well, I guess the one that gets the most commentary back to me is probably my look for the Oscars for Erin Brockovich.
I was hoping you would say that.
Yeah.
It was beautiful.
Thank you.
Where is that dress?
It's under my bed in a, like, it's in a box. It's not like just under the bed.
You're like, I dust with it. You're known as this glamorous movie star to your fans, but what do you look like on an everyday basis?
I look just like this.
Yeah, you look like this.
And I'm gonna go to sleep with a bag over my head and look just like this tomorrow.
Okay, fill in the blank. I would never wear
a thong bathing suit.
Me neither. do you go shopping like online or in stores?
Yeah.
You do?
Uh-huh.
What do you buy?
Where do you think I get my clothes?
I don't know. I want to know.
They just appeared. You like think about it. And,
you know, you're Julia Roberts.
Yeah.
Where does she get her clothes?
Rag and bone, and then it just blink.
What do you like
there.
To buy? Like, what clothes do you like to buy?
I don't know. Pants that make your butt look small,
mm-hmm.
right?
What item in your closet do you wear the most often?
I heard one time that we wear 20% of our wardrobe 80% of the time.
That's right.
And I do that, mm-hmm. and I'm sick of it.
We can go shopping anytime. what's the oldest thing in your closet? I feel like that sometimes. You have your dress from the Oscars.
I do.
But that's under your bed.
It is under my bed. I mean, I actually have a jean jacket.
Yes.
From a major motion picture called Satisfaction, which starred Justine Bateman.
So glad you brought it up so I didn't have to.
Yeah.
The best.
It's
movie.
Okay. I've long let go of anything about how silly I am in that movie.
silly amazing. The best movie. What clothes or accessories are you saving for your daughter or your sons?
Well, I have this little space in my house that my husband refers to as the heritage collection of things. I go, I can't get rid of them. What about Hazel? What, you know?
Yeah.
And he's like, well, what if, you know, 20 years from now, she just wants her own stuff and just want all of your old stuff. I say, well, but maybe she'll want it.
Yeah.
So I keep keeping things.
Does she experiment with her personal style or do your sons?
Probably Finn is the most fashion oriented, the most style oriented. Mm-hmm. But Hazel has just a natural style. And Henry has a real kind of athletic style.
If Serge, who's amazing, ever came to you and said, I'm thinking Bob, I just want to cut it all off, would you let him?
You have no idea how many times I've said that to Serge.
No.
And he says this to me, no baby.
Wow, mm-hmm. Really?
Mm-hmm.
So you would make a huge change like that?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. We'll be on the lookout.
I might have to go to Supercuts.
Can you imagine? That's really funny. What about the bigger stuff, like Botox, fillers, plastic surgery?
Just that it's all super cool and interesting, and I think that we should all do what we want.
I like that.
Yeah.
Have you embraced aging? Or are you fighting it? Because I'm fighting it. It's
well,
my job.
We have to put up a little bit of a fight.
Yeah.
But then too much of a fight causes wrinkles.
That's a really good point. They tell you not to stress, because if you make this face, you need Botox. We have a thing at People where people tell us what they eat in a day. So if we were to hang out with you all day.
How much time do you have?
Well, I want to know. So like, what do you eat in a day?
Oh gosh, I don't know. What do I mean? I love to eat eggs for breakfast.
Scrambled.
See,
fried.
This is when you say, "Come on, people at home, wake up!" Mm-hmm. Start dozing off. I'm talking about eggs.
Eggs they find it fascinating.
Over easy sourdough mm-hmm. toast, avocado.
Now we're going to lunch. Where are we right. going?
Lunch would be like, you know, a salad with chicken or mm-hmm. pasta.
Pasta.
Are you shocked that I would
yes!
eat pasta?
I love that.
Why is everybody scared of pasta?
People are terrified.
Why?
I don't know. People tell me all the time I'm not supposed to eat pasta.
Pasta never did
love
anything
it.
To you. Don't be mean to pasta.
And then where are we going for dinner? And are we having wine?
Dinner, of course.
Okay, good.
I like to cook a lot of fish. My kids like fish, so fish, rice, salad. It's kind of tacos.
Delicious. What's your weakness when it comes to food? Is it pasta?
No, it's cookies.
Chocolate
I love
chip.
A good cookie. And I guess cheese.
Ooh.
Right? I'd yeah. be more scared of cheese than I would be of pasta.
Okay, so you're the face of several Lancome campaigns. You have been over time. What's harder, supermodel or super actress?
Well, I like to feel like when I'm doing my super modeling that I really put the super into the super modeling.
Mm-hmm.
It's just such a fun job. And everybody,
is it?
Oh my.
Is it as
yeah.
glamorous as it looks?
Yeah.
yeah.
It really is, because it's the focus is so absurdly, like, for something to be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
So to have an entire army of people pursuing that on your behalf is pretty great.
So cool. And if you have an hour to yourself, how are you spending it?
Do you want my real answer or
yes.
the answer that makes me sound like I'm rad?
Both? What's the real one?
Probably sit on the couch and
play Mahjong?
Watch TV.
What are you watching?
Do you really want to know?
Yes.
Okay. The second season of Friday Night Lights.
Oh, I mean, that's amazing.
It's so good, but I think everybody knows that but me.
Oh,
I'm
so
catching
good.
Up.
So good.
I can't believe how long ago this show was on and then I missed it.
So good. So I have a game too. It's called This or That. It's really easy.
You're so just adorable.
Well, thank you. Okay, massage or facial?
Facial.
Red lips or smoky eyes?
Smoky eyes.
I know this is tough stuff, so. Mani or pedi?
Pedi.
Straight or curly?
You know, a little texture goes a long way.
Jumpsuit or gown?
Jumpsuit.
You love a jumpsuit on the red
Hell
carpet.
Hell yeah.
Sleep in or workout?
Workout.
Yoga or spin?
Yoga.
Okay. Blow dry or air dry? told you these were hard.
I know. There's pros and cons to both.
Okay. Legs or cleavage?
Legs.
Always. Baked, mashed, or fried?
Baked.
Okay. Sweet or salty?
I like a salted chocolate chip cookie.
In store or online?
Huh. Wow. Like a Mensa meeting.
I know.
I mean, online is easier, but more deadly.
Yes, it is. Coffee or cocktails?
Coffee.
This one's really hard.
Okay.
Clooney or Gear?
Well, there's pros and cons to both. It's like the blow dry, air dry.
Totally.
Yeah.
You just love them both. Can't choose. Can't choose. Diplomatic.
Why would I have to?
Tell us later.
Yeah.
Okay. That's it.
Ta-da!
Made it easy.